Where did Jesus go to? I don't know exactly, but I sure hope that he comes back very soon. Because the extreme cultural makeover is accelerating to an extraordinary extent, and I have unparalleled clarity on this now this morning. And you know, if I talk about this, it might rattle some cages. I know that there are a lot of, you know, those who watch this video, that they're all, you know, we're all enmeshed in this situation here to some extent. It there's pressure on us. And I don't want to put too much pressure on anyone because it can cause panic retreat. Now, I had a dream last night where I retreated in panic. I panicked in the dream. And I said, wow, that's not good. It's exactly what I was telling everyone in the videos. I tell you, full stop in the wow so you don't panic. Well, the progress that I had made in the video yesterday was so strong that I got nervous, and I went back to graphics and music. And this ultimately in the dream caused me to suddenly panic and believe I was being pursued. And when you're being believe you're being pursued, there's a tendency to imagine that someone's pursuing you. And this is what I saw in the dream. Okay, that graphic just popped up when I went to start the video, so I just let it stay there as a nice segue to start the video. What I saw was I was panicking, I was fleeing because I thought that someone was pursuing me. I was being pursued. Now, when we are fleeing in a panic, don't we automatically assume we're being pursued? So I went back to the dream and I was looking at it, and I said, was I really being pursued, or was I just sort of imagining that there was a pursuit? And I think, and I said, you know what, it's most likely I was just imagining that I was being pursued. It was this dream about this. I was on this big pine tree and this bear came and climbed up the tree to the very top. And then suddenly I said, oh my gosh, what if the bear comes down? The bear comes down. And I, for some reason, I panicked and I slid down the trunk of the tree as fast as possible and running to in the backyard to get behind a fence, defenses. And I looked back to see, and I thought I saw a glimpse of the bear pursuing me. But it was more likely just a shadow that I had projected the bear image upon. I didn't really see the bear come down from the tree. I didn't see the bear actually pursue me. I didn't see any of that. I assumed the bear was pursuing me. So when we're in full flight, feeling that we're something's pursuing us, trying to destroy us, don't we assume that there is something pursuing us? We do. And if there's nothing pursuing us, don't we hallucinate that there's something pursuing us? Don't we imagine? We absolutely do. So this is where I started my looking inquiry into this dream, because I was very upset with disappointed in myself. All this work, my whole life I've been working not to panic, not to lose, and what did I do? I panicked. As the bear got to the top of the tree, I suddenly, something says, what if they come down? You know, and I just like, oh my gosh, and I lost it. Just like I panicked yesterday evening, and so went back into graphics and then the music. And I just was trying to calm myself down. I was really, you know, the success was frightening. So I began this inquiry into this whole situation. This inquiry is expanded and expanded and expanded. And ultimately, where has it brought me? It's ultimately brought me to the question, is Jesus coming back? Is there a refuge from this world, actually? And I don't have an answer to that. You know, I need an answer. And I think a lot of us need an answer. The radical, cultural makeover of this planet is in full gear right now. And I understand it now at a level that beyond, way beyond what I've previously understood. I've been right about it all along, but the overall big picture, you know, where, what's generating this? You know, now I see that also. So it remains to be seen. Is there going to be an exodus from this planet? Is there going to be a relocation? Are we going to be able to take refuge? Because we literally have a takeover of this planet, and we have this Bureau of Culture, this Office of Culture, this Planetary Office of Culture now, that is being staffed by those loyal to the takeover, where literally whatever you want to present for the public's consumption must be okayed by this Office for Planetary Culture and those staffing it. Now, to use an analogy, but I'm not trying to be analogous in every way here. I just want to point out, for instance, the Roman Catholic Church had an office of culture, so to speak, and anything that was going to be printed by any Catholics or anyone in the country, the Catholic country, had to go through this office of culture to make sure it wasn't blasphemous, it wasn't subversive. And so culture went through the Catholic Church and had to be approved. Okay, so what's taking place is similar, except the difference is what they're approving. You know, what they're approving and what they're disapproving. They're now disapproving what I call truth. Actually, they're disapproving truth and only approving what goes on with their arrogance. I call it spiritual arrogance. So, and I'm just observing and watch. I've been observing the world for 58 years, actually, and knowing that this would take place, and it is taking place exactly as I was told by the Holy Spirit. This is what's going to happen. It is happening. It's astonishing how rapidly it's happening. I can monitor it through sports programming, which I'm very familiar with, and very keenly aware of the cultural politics in sports programming, because sports programming is aimed at men, okay? And I'm aware that this cultural takeover is essentially aimed at getting men in compliance with it, because men tend to have a maverick nature. We're less susceptible to groupthink and going into compliance. We have a sort of tendency to go rogue and when it as far as conforming to a cultural demand, you know. So there's a very, very, very strong push to get all the men of the world knowing what their role is under this new cosmic corporate culture, which has incorporated this planet, this hostile takeover. And so sports is super important, because men take their cues from their sporting heroes, okay? And the sport, and a lot of men do. And an astonishing thing has been happening in sports programming. And it's so astonishing, I'm just like, my jaw is almost dropping. I said, what in the world is going on here? I watched a little bit of an NBA playoff game. Golden State Warriors are in the playoffs. I watched a little bit of it. And then I went to the post game. I said, there's the post game. And I saw two regular guys that had been there, and they go back and forth, blah blah blah, and you know, and it's okay, talking about the game and the banter and everything. And I said, what? It opens up on this dolled up woman. I said, what's this? I said, I've seen this before. What's going on? And then it opens up, and she's talking, all hair all curly and made up and glamorous model in a reptilian type of dress. And I said, wait a minute. We just had this really exciting basketball game. And then the euphoria of that, of this triumph, you know, goes right to this glamorous reptilian model. Obviously, one of these cultural attachés who, and then the camera opens up to the two men, and they're kind of sitting there, you know, waiting, not saying anything. and she prattles on about blah 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 blah. And then she asks a question, man. Hey, Joe. What do you think about this, huh? And then Joe says, well, yeah, blah blah. And she goes, okay, now you. And so she's running the whole show. She's the producer of the show. I said, wow, okay. It's here too. It's here. It's suddenly, it's all pervasive in men's sports programming. That instead of like two guys talking, there's now three. Always there's a woman now. And the woman is the producer of the show. She's the moderator, like an Oprah. See, all of these women took their cues from Oprah. Oprah was a very important part of this takeover, cosmic corporate culture takeover of this planet. And what she did was, she gave a role model for these operatives of cosmic corporate culture. So you need to be part of this Office of Planetary Culture, which Oprah feels she's the head of it, basically, where nothing gets into culture except it goes through you, and you're the gatekeeper. Okay, you're the gatekeepers of culture. And so she showed them how to be in charge and producing a show with men there and the men could only say, if they start to go off, say something she doesn't want, to get let through the cultural, as a cultural gatekeeper, let through into culture, she knows how to stop them right away. Like, oh, what? She looks offended, like startled, offended. Like, and the men goes, and the men immediately go, oh God, I'm gonna lose my job. The men you see on in the media, wherever you see men giving cultural information, they're terrified that they're going to lose their job if they make one little mistake that the gatekeepers of planetary culture, they catch it and they say, oh, that's a bad mistake. They're out. The double standard is amazing in this world right now, where there's someone on ESPN, one of the sports presenters, a woman, of course. They're taking over the male programming sports. They're in the role of the producer. I mean, they're in charge now. And she went into some rant that was caught on video, berating some employee at some car rental company. And I guess I didn't listen to what she said. Doesn't matter to me. And she was immediately, oh, I apologize, suspended for a week. That's it. Nobody commented more than that. Okay, suspended for a week. And then a week she'll be back and everything's fine. Okay. Now, if a man did that, he would be immediately fired. He would be, first he'd be tarred and feathered, and then he'd be tied to a stake and burned at the stake. Okay, there's no question about it. And many, 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 many men have suffered this fate. Their reputation's completely ruined. And so the men that are left are absolutely, you can tell they're sweating. I'm looking at these panels and you can see the men are just like the tension and the sweat. They're terrified that they might say something that this cultural gatekeeper will flag. Basically, they've been trained how to flag anything that doesn't fit in with new cosmic corporate culture. And so the media and entertainment and news is a big part of it. But education, all the institutions now have these gatekeepers. If you look at the spokespersons for most corporations, they're almost all women now, the spokespersons. In fact, almost all the spokespersons who are commenting culturally are women now. And you cannot, now, this has permeated the spiritual realm also. I've been knowing this for a long time, is that any male spiritual teacher now has to have a female sidekick. And the female sidekick actually is a cultural gatekeeper. They're not there for enlightenment. They're there to be a cultural gatekeeper, making sure that this teacher understands that if they want to have their message presented to the masses, that they're going to have to tailor it in a way that is agreeable to the higher-ups in the Office of Planetary Culture, which is ultimately this cosmic corporate culture takeover of this planet. And it's so pervasive. One of the problems we have is it's so pervasive that when we try to speak of it, people can easily say, well, you're paranoid. The idea of someone being paranoid is they see something everywhere, so to speak. But, you know, that's like in the 60s, you say, hey, I see yellow Volkswagens everywhere. And the psychiatrist says, yeah, you're showing paranoid tendencies. I say, no, I actually counted them. You know, and there's like one out of every six cars is a yellow VW. And if they're unaware of this fact, then they'll claim you're paranoid. You know, you have paranoid tendencies. And so this is one of the ego's biggest defenses, actually, is its pervasiveness. And what it does is so strong and so pervasive that when you point it out to others, the ego will say, I can't possibly be that bad or that pervasive, so you must be paranoid, you must be mistaken. But if you underreport it, you know, then you mislead people, you see. And people say, well, it's not so bad, it's not so bad. So this is a damned if you do, damned if you don't classic setup, which is the root of the ego. Okay, the root of the ego, which is basically the root of the ego, is our own spiritual arrogance saying to God, damned if you do, damned if you don't. You have to accept this deal. If you don't accept this deal, that proves you're imperfect. So it's really our arrogance. And our arrogance is all pervasive, virtually all pervasive in this world. And it's in play constantly, constantly in play. So we do, there is no doubt about it, is what I have been preaching my whole life, is that there's going to be this cosmic corporate culture takeover, a hostile takeover of this planet. This is Christian theology, Christian eschatology teaches this for sure. And, but I got it from a knowing from the Holy Spirit somehow. I was born with this. I knew this was going to happen. So I think there was a warning about it, cosmic warning about it in spirit, and then various people came into this world to help warn the planet about it. So I was one of those who came into this world to say, hey, you know, this is what's going to happen. You better prepare for it. And I've said by June 21st of 2016, this takeover will be essentially completed. And it's already so far down the road that you know, it's this juggernaut. It's this absolute juggernaut that is just a runaway, just crushing everything in its path. And so I say, well, how can I present, you know, truth to the world? Because these sidekicks, these gatekeepers of cosmic corporate culture descend upon you. And say, okay, this is how you have to say it. This is how you have to be. You have to show that you're under the authority. It's the same thing like in Communist China. Communist China was a trial run by cosmic corporate culture, actually. And what they did was they had members of the Central Party, the Communist Party. They sat in on every committee at the local level, at, you know, all the way up to the highest bureaucracy. You had to have a member of the Communist Party as a cultural gatekeeper monitoring everything you said and did. And they would then pull you aside and said, hey, you know, you need to change your spiel. You need to change what you're saying because it's not in alignment with our policies. And they'd completely intimidated the entire country and turned everybody into, you know, quivering jellyfish, afraid to say anything, and even went down to training children to spy on their parents, all the way down to the family level. And we have the same situation now, globally, but especially, and just speaking of the United States, but it's globally, the extreme importance where we have these now gatekeepers. And we say, well, that can't happen. Really, it happened in Communist China. They had millions of these operatives who were monitoring every aspect of life. And you had to then change your tune or suffer. You'd be breaking rocks in Xinjiang, was it Tashkent or Samarkand or something. I mean, you'd be building a road out in the Taklamakan desert, which is exactly what you'd be doing. If you didn't comply, oh, gee, we needed road workers. You're a hero of the road. Well, you see, we have a great opportunity for you, having a hard time singing our tune, but we know you're a good person, so we have a great opportunity for you to be a hero of the revolution, and we need infrastructure out in Taklamakan. And so you get to go out there with your family, or maybe no family, but move out there and help build the infrastructure. So what basically did was they, using sledgehammers or whatever they had, breaking stone in the sun all day to then lay out for, you know, the bedrock for a road, and you lasted, I think, about the average lifespan doing that, average time lasts about 3 years before you died. Okay. Now, here they'll just cut off your funds, cut off your ability to work, which is pretty much a death sentence. You know, homeless. Here, nobody will help you. Oh, you're a pariah. The cosmic corporate culture gatekeepers have labeled you a pariah. A sort of a spiritual ghetto we're living in right now. We're literally living, I feel like I'm living in a spiritual ghetto, actually. Referring to the ghettos that the Jews were sequestered into in the big cities of, you know, Eastern Europe and Europe. But we're living in a spiritual ghetto right now, where those who see what's going on and recognize, say, hey, that's not the way of salvation. This is a way of entrapment. That they're being labeled, you know, putting a star on them and putting them in the ghetto for future future plans. bad type of relocation. They'll say, oh, sure, we'll relocate you, but we'll relocate you to some productive work here and dig in your own graves. And so the proliferation is what I was expecting, and it's what's happened. And it's astonishing how it happened literally overnight. Overnight. And there's no announcement of it. And this is the way they work. Once they get to a certain level, they will suddenly flood the world with their operatives. This is the way that China worked. Is suddenly the whole paradigm seems to shift. And now it's the women who are producing everything, these operatives. And same with the sporting events right after they're finished. Always now, immediately after the game, the hero of the game who represents the conquest, the winning conquest, immediately there's this woman there, young woman usually, acting like she's the one that produced the whole thing. It says, okay, so Joe, hey, good job out there, Joe. It's like as if it's her team. Good job out there, Joe. I liked how you did this and this and this, and how you feeling right now? Tell everybody how you're feeling right now. And so she is this acting like an Oprah producer. She's bringing you this entertainment. She's bringing you this is her team. This is her conquest. And it's amazing, the change in attitude. I just turn off the television. I can't stand it. It's really repulsive what they're doing, and I realize what they're up to. But in order to recognize what the cosmic corporate culture is up to, you have to go deep, deep, deep into spiritual understanding. And honestly, I can't find this sort of teaching. I have to do it myself, it seems like. It seems ridiculous. But the traditions of the East don't touch upon this, really. They don't touch upon the cosmos. And the overall why is all this arising in the first place? They just say none of it's real. Well, sure, none of it's real. I mean, ultimately, they're speaking truth, but they're leaving out something very, very relevant, I feel, that Christianity seems to have. Christianity takes a perspective of telling us that we're under pressure, and the pressure can get very severe. And we're under extreme, they call it Luciferian conspiracy, something like that. And it talks about the whole situation, the trouble we have is due to our own spiritual pride. And I use the term arrogance. And I believe this is very true, very accurate. And the Eastern teachings don't really teach upon that. So I find in some ways they're somewhat lacking. I'd rather have a completer picture. So that's why I bring this up, because It is, I feel it's absolutely true that all this self-delusion that we're engaged in, which spiritual teachings are designed to help us awaken from, like this dream. But why are we dreaming in the first place? And the Eastern teachings just say, well, some adventitious circumstance, or we don't really know why we started dreaming. That's nonsense. That's just begging off the question entirely. We absolutely do know why we started dreaming. I certainly know. The Christian teachings do point us in that direction, and Jesus certainly helps us focus on that as being very important. And the fact is that we wanted to be greater than God, period. Isn't that the Luciferian fall from grace, so to speak, that we are taught? Is this Lucifer wanted to be greater than God? Lucifer was the most brightest angel, so to speak. Angels mean spirits, really. Spirit. But there is no brighter spirit, a lesser or brighter spirit. So this is just sort of an anthropomorphic story about it. But what spirit had this idea? Now, it could have been a spirit, so to speak, had this idea and has led others astray. That's possible. So they say Lucifer was the spirit that had this idea of being greater than God. Now, this is sheer arrogance. Sheer arrogance. It's impossible to be greater than perfection. You cannot be somewhere other than everywhere. You cannot be more than the allness. It's impossible. So to assert that I want to do this is nothing but sheer arrogance and folly and whim. Anyway, we quote unquote, since we've all here been led astray, you know, and we said, let me try this too. You know, maybe there was one spirit that started it. Maybe that was Lucifer. But we have gone along with it. So we have to take responsibility for that too. So we'll use a general we term, spirit. When we take this position of wanting to be greater than God, it's sheer arrogance. What we do is we don't want to recognize it as sheer arrogance, because sheer arrogance means that it's folly. It's not possible. We're just arrogating the possibility to ourselves that God is not involved in this arrogation whatsoever. We're just out of nothing, we're arrogating this, and we have no capacity to do that whatsoever. God did not create us with the will to arrogate that we're greater than God's will. So, I mean, it's empty. It's empty. This arrogation is empty. What we do then is we, instead of recognizing that it's empty, we try to camouflage the arrogance so as to try and modify the emptiness of it. And this camouflaging of the arrogance is what we call making a deal with God. And this is at the root, ultimately, of this problem, of this hostile takeover of this planet, and these cultural gatekeepers who are now, you're going to find the world is swarmed with them. The swarm has already happened, like locusts swarming throughout the world. Also, the Christian teaching calls them the whores of Babylon, actually. And they're told that this would happen in the end times. And the whores of Babylon would be drunk on the blood of the saints, meaning that they would be giddy with the power that they have over the righteous, holy people of the world, being able to control what they say. And they're gatekeepers. They have power over them. This is exactly what we're told, and this is exactly what's happening. And it's through and through the book publishing industry, through the magazine publishing, through all appearances on television, through the stage, the theater, all movies, all forms of cultural expression are now have multiple layers of gatekeepers, all working for cosmic corporate culture, as do politics. Okay. And as do bureaucracy. So it's an interwoven, intermeshed, massive bureaucracy of cultural gatekeepers here, all working in basic sync, okay, because they understand the basic direction they're going in. And that direction that they're going in is a continued assertion that a deal was made with God. Okay, a deal was made with God. Let's just, it's easy to simplify it, and it's true to simplify it, because this is ultimately what's going on here in this planet. Those who continue trying to camouflage their arrogance, and so therefore believe their desire to be greater than God isn't totally empty, but actually has something to it. They are the ones, this is the mindset, this is the direction that these cosmic corporate gatekeepers are flagging anyone who doesn't go in that direction. They're flagging them, right and left. Every day, you see more and more news articles of some people have been flagged, almost all of them men. If a woman's flagged, it's pretty much brushed under the carpet, brushed and swept under the rug, and because that might... that by people saying, hey, wait a minute, you know, women aren't so perfect, not perfect, really? Because these gatekeepers are pretending like they have perfect understanding and of what's right, best and right for the world, which is to keep believing that a deal was made with God. That is the essential point of the essential recognition of this whole situation, is we think we're here, and we're in this, enmeshed in this horrible nightmare, because we believe a deal was made with God, plain and simple. And this isn't brought to light in spiritual teaching that I'm aware of. And so I hate to be a maverick and bring it to light, because people say, well, you know, Ramana doesn't say that. And anyway, well, and no. Maybe, you know, I asked Ramana this morning, hey, how come you didn't talk about this? And he says, that's what you're for. You know, that's what you're for. Why do I do that? You're going to do that. And I say, holy cow, that's putting a lot of responsibility on my shoulders, you know. But maybe people would not believe this until they actually recognize it here. This is a great time of recognition in the world right now. And to speak of this sort of stuff ahead of time, they feel people would say, you know, that's kind of, I don't know, that's pretty way out there or something. Whereas Christianity certainly did tackle it from the very beginning. They were very much aware of the situation on this planet and what's going to happen. And they seem to have an understanding that they're going to be moving to some other place once it gets really bad. Well, as I've said, by 2:16, June of 21st, 2:16, you had better be ready, spiritually ready, because by that time, this gatekeeping, cultural gatekeeping, will be like an iron curtain, okay, on this planet. Really, we talk about the iron curtain. This iron curtain around this whole planet is what the problem is. And these cultural gatekeepers are vicious vixens. They're fiends, really. And I realize as I'm watching the media throughout my life, and I look at the television, I said, you know what? The television is being used as a training program to turn people into fiends, to bring about a fiendish mindset. And now that's exactly what's happening in this world. Those who've been raised on this modern culture have a very fiendish mindset. And that's their purpose, is to be ferociously flagging anyone who doesn't believe that a deal was made with God. And, you know, it's off with their heads mentality is really prevalent in this world. They're just playing cute and curling their hair now, but later on they'll straighten things out. Keep in mind, in the Cultural Revolution of China, the women were the most vicious. They were the most vicious, okay? And they gave the orders to the men, off with their heads. They can be very severe ideologues on this issue, and I know why now, and we can trace it back. And I say can be, but there's two streams of female on this planet, those who want salvation and those who want to continue on with this idea, notion, false notion, that a deal was made with God. And so those are the sheep and the goats. And so I'm not trying to put all women in the same basket at all, because ultimately I was also aware that in the early 70s, about 1973, there were books being written. There were all these encounter sessions taking place, and many, many women were actually engaged in all this. More women were in therapy and encounter groups than men, okay? And what happened in those was they were being practicing honesty. They wanted spiritual salvation, and they began to go into their psyche, the greater psyche, and see the greater picture, and they began to realize, hey, wait a minute. We've just been manipulating men all throughout history, actually. We're the ones actually in charge, and we're the ones who have been using men for our own plans of conquest all along. And they saw it, and they said, wow. And then there was this other group who said, hey, wait a minute, though. If men find out about this, they'll never trust you again, and this will cause a permanent rift, and we can't have that. We have to keep using men for our conquest, you know. You can't. And so there was a split in the early 70s between feminists, the type of feminists who said, hey, I too can be spiritually liberated, I can be enlightened, that's what I want. And those who said, no, I want to just have more and more conquests, actually, and get more and more of what I think I want, material power and stuff. There was a big split, and that went into what's called radical feminism. And radical feminism basically made a deal with the extraterrestrials, with cosmic corporate culture, and began to be trainers for these gatekeepers, these cultural gatekeepers now, who are flagging anything that doesn't align with what cosmic corporate culture wants. And it's the radical feminists who are basically, they're the higher-ups in politics, in bureaucracy, etc. Those are the intellectuals. The radical feminists are the intellectuals who are done the training through the universities. A lot of, you know, there's way more women in universities now than men, and the universities are essentially radical feminist institutions now, and they've trained these cultural gatekeepers, women going to universities, to be these gatekeepers, and then they in turn have been training others below them. So there's this whole training program that's actually taken place. But there are also some women who want enlightenment. You know, and so they've been struggling, saying, wait a minute, I don't want to keep on living a lie. You know, I know how that goes. I don't want to do that. So that's also happening. Yet, they've been under siege to play ball so as to not provide a contrast and so make everyone think, no, this is some sort of... this is part of the deal we made with God, what's happening in this world. And this is the big lie. The big lie is that this, what's happening in the world, is part of, a necessary part of the deal that we made with God. Okay, I want to say this very clearly to everyone. We never made any deal with God. It's impossible to make a deal with God. No deal with God has ever been made. Yes, I already know that no deal with God has ever been made. Yes, I already know that no deal with God is ever possible. So this is a total fabrication, a total lie. It's the big lie. And yet, if we don't see this, we don't recognize our own arrogance, for sure we will believe that this is part of the deal we made with God. It's what we have to do to keep our part of the deal. This is the big lie that we're being told. This is the big Luciferian lie. So Lucifer, you know, wants to camouflage our Luciferia, you know, to be fair about the whole situation. If you want to be fair, you might as well call it Luciferia instead of Lucifer. Because the thing is that part of this delusional plan, which is a camouflage of our arrogance, is to identify with form, life forms we call it. And so the replication of life forms is primarily essential for this, to keep our delusion of camouflaging our arrogance and believing that our arrogance isn't empty, okay? That we can be greater than God. Replicating life forms is essential to this. So the female component, the replicators of life forms, are way more essential than the male forms. So the spirit believes that females are the caretakers of this whole plan, this whole deal. They're the ones who are holding this whole deal together. And so they're the heroines of this deal, and the men just don't quite get it. You know, spirit always feels, well, men, they can't trust them because they're not replicators of bodies, and so they're not that important in this whole keeping the deal with God. You know, so the females are told by spirit as identifying as a replicator of body, so to speak, is keeping this deal together, places greater emphasis on the feminine component of this replicator of bodies, and says that they're the ones who really know what's going on, because they're the ones who realize that a deal was made, and they're the ones that are all important for this deal to be kept, and therefore they're essential, and they understand the deal. So this is what's happening, is these radical feminists, cosmic corporate culture gatekeepers, which has permeated the whole globe now. They're extremely arrogant because they feel they understand the deal, and they feel that men don't understand the deal, and men are very dangerous because they'll get God angry, because men are not capable of understanding what the deal's all about. So the women think they have some mysterious inner knowledge of this deal, okay, that men just don't have that level of understanding. No, what these women have is a more thorough indoctrination into how to flag something that doesn't go along with this deal. That's what they have. That doesn't mean they have some deeper understanding of the deal, because actually there is no deal. There is no deal. And that's what they don't want anyone to, you know, they don't want us to know this. That's it. And so what they do is they say anyone who says there's no deal is just a misogynist trying to repress women's power and their deep knowledge and understanding and their roles and their purpose and their importance and all this. Of course that's what they're going to say, because they get their sense of importance from believing that they're special, essentially special, for this whole deal to work that we supposedly made with God. And so anytime a man says, hey, or anyone, a woman too, okay, anytime anyone says there is no deal, they say, you're undermining our self-worth, our self-esteem, you're anti-woman, you're anti, you know, and they go into this rabid rant. And this will happen to women too. If any woman says it, they'll also pounce on her, but not quite as strongly, because they're afraid that they'll say, you know, they'll be set an example, like, hey, you can speak back to a woman. So they kind of just try to shun her off to the side and say, hey, you know, just don't, quiet, be quiet here, don't say much. But if a man says it, that, you know, the pitchforks are out. But, you know, ultimately, of course, spirit, there's no gender to spirit at all. But this whole idea of bodies and replicating bodies is something that we have simply made up, imagined as part of the deal that we've made with God. This world, bodies, nature, all of this is something we have invented. We've imagined it, spiritually imagined it, because this symbolizes part of the deal that we claim that we made with God, plain and simple. And of course, when we realize there's no deal with God, it's impossible to make a deal with God, then we certainly don't need this bodies and world and nature and all this stuff at all, do we? But the women claim, no, wait a minute, I'm essential to life itself, replicating bodies. I'm the giver of life. I'm the creator of life. This is part of God's plan. God created me to extend the life, and I extend life through bodies and all this. This is utter nonsense, okay? The claim that there's a God that creates bodies and worlds, etc., that's part of this so-called deal that we've made with God. That's part of our belief. We say now God is a God creating bodies and worlds, etc., and that's part of this deal. Okay, this belief is part of the deal that we believe we've made with God. And no such deal exists. No such deal exists. There is no God who is a designer of some script that everybody has to play out, and we all have just roles that we have to play out in the script and make sure we look at the script and make sure we're following the script and everything. There's nothing like that whatsoever in reality. Reality is total perfect freedom, and that's it. Nothing other than that. There is no script for us to follow. There is no deal with God. You cannot make a deal with perfect freedom. It's impossible. So the spirit, under the guise of the feminine aspect, has actually demanded that men produce religions that reflect this deal. And so we have this religions, and Christianity in part showcases this, is this angry Jehovah God, you know, the Old Testament. That's all just nothing but an invention that women told men that this is what you have to do. This is something you can do for us, okay? Make up these rituals, make up these sacrifices and stuff like that. Women really have been in charge throughout all history, actually. They're always in charge. They're the essential to this so-called deal. Okay, so they're more essential to the so-called deal, except there isn't any deal whatsoever. But they don't want to lose this feeling of specialness and essentialness to some plan or script. In reality, there's no specialness. God has absolutely no preference. There's not one thought of God that shows the slightest preference to anything. Okay, no such thing as specialness in reality. Absolute perfect freedom for all. So, but in this dream, this dream is just a camouflage for spiritual arrogance. We come up with a specialness, special role, specially important to keep this deal, make sure we keep our part of the bargain. Otherwise, the deal will fall apart. See, we're terrified the deal's going to fall apart. Well, of course, falling apart means we'll recognize our arrogance is empty. And that's always there. Our arrogance to say that we can be greater than God is totally empty, always. But we, in our camouflaging, we think that we've been able to change that. But we're afraid we might fall back into that. So we have to keep our part of the deal, keep replicating bodies as much as possible, keep making sure that we honor the replicators above all else and do what they tell us to do because they have some special insight into this plan. They understand their essentialness of the plan, and if they lose that feeling of being essential, they might stop replicating. The whole plan will fall apart. So women play the central role in this plan, of this deal, by replicating bodies. So the men are like, you know, terrified. Tell us what to do. Tell us what to do. We don't want this plan to fall apart. And the women say, okay, to do this. And they change their tune throughout history. But most of it has to do with conquest of various types, because this makes us feel safer from an abyss, from the emptiness, from this arrogance being empty. We're trying to fill it up with we feel being we're being pursued, and we need to, you know, get rid of this pursuer and conquest. So men have just basically been used throughout history as a means to conquest, to make the overall feminine replicator of bodies feel that they're more protected, that they're safer. You know, it's just this is the dynamic. So men have just been cannon fodder throughout history, basically. And of course, even that is being covered up now. When they talk about war and stuff, now that it's the female who's the hero of the war, they're the ones who do the fighting. And now any man on any broadcast who uses the talking about the armed forces, in battle are brave. Like, in, you know, there's some horrible battle raging in some town where men are getting slaughtered, and they have to say now, our brave men and women who are engaged in this in combat and putting their lives at risk, as if throughout all of history that women have equally shared the terrible trauma of the battlefield, which is, you know, the most incredible lie, most utter heinous type of lie. Okay, how many women were fighting at Guadalcanal or Iwo Jima or etc.? Zero. On the front lines, zero. Okay, zero. How about through history? Mostly zero. And yet now, you have to speak of them as if the risk has been equally shared throughout history, which is just the most abominably arrogant lie. Okay, and men are just not saying anything about it. It is the most disrespectful thing you could hardly possibly say. You know, it's just complete revisionism. Now, women have played supporting roles in nursing and stuff, but even that wasn't very prevalent until recently. But the idea that somehow women have actually, they've been the ones, eventually they'll say, no, women are the ones who really did most of the fighting all throughout history, and people won't even say anything. I guarantee if a feminist got up there and said, radical feminist got up there and said, it's women who have put their lives at risk most throughout history in the battlefield. They're the ones who truly did the great fighting, and nobody would say a thing. They just kind of look at one another and say, "Are we supposed to say anything?" You got all these male commentators. You get a whole room of male commentators, and one woman, a gatekeeper, cosmic corporate culture gatekeeper there, saying, guess what, guys? Hi, I'm Jill Joe, you know, G.I. Jill. I'm G.I. Jill, and I'm the one who's done all the fighting, so you need to bow down to me as your new general. The men will all look at each other and say, well, are we supposed to say something? And they just, like, be trembling and shaking. You know, so I, okay, G.I. Jill, whatever you say. That's what they do, whatever you say, G.I. Jill. Now, the fact that very recently some women have been in combat doesn't in any way mean that they have been throughout history. Okay. And even that, their numbers are very, very limited. And even so, they're put in protective situations as much as possible. They're not assuming the strongest risk, not even minuscule compared to men throughout history. It's not even a fraction of 1%. And yet they're making it seem like it's 50-50. Has been 50-50. Uh-oh. Let me see. Just have to tick that off. Okay. So this is where we're at. We're at literally at the point where no man can say anything, no matter how egregious the lie is. No man can say anything, really, if they expect to have a future here. So, I must not expect to have a future here, I would say. That's for sure. Or, if you want to have any voice in society whatsoever, if you have any voice in society whatsoever, you cannot say these things that I'm saying. And just showed by the number of views I have here, and YouTube is very small. There's not many courageous souls in the world, because someone will later say, were you watching those videos? Oh, you're flagged too, you know? You're flagged too. So it takes very courageous, very aware spirit to watch these videos and to hear this. And people are chickening out. They say, oh my God, which way will you have to go? Well, again, let's point out there are only two ways to go. One way is to believe a deal what has been made with God, and that we're engaged in keeping this deal, and we need to follow those who understand the deal and do what they say, otherwise the deal will break down. So we basically become slaves, spiritual slaves. We live in a spiritual ghetto where we have to say what the gatekeepers, the cosmic corporate culture gatekeepers, we have to do what they tell us to do, say what they tell us to say, believe what they tell us to believe, act the way they tell us to act. And this is going to be an absolute tyranny. It's a cultural tyranny. We're looking for some big, you know, political figure to go up there and put everybody in prison or something. No, the imprisonment is coming from these cute, dolled up ladies, you call them, whatever you want to call them, fiends, actually, who are acting as cosmic corporate gatekeepers. We don't dare say anything that would affront them, affront their, you know, I feel like my ability to replicate bodies is being disrupted by your effrontery. Oh my gosh, this is terrible. And everyone goes, oh, no. We don't want to get God mad at us, you know. Get rid of that idiot. That's the mood of the world. It's a fiendish mood in the world because all these fiends have now moved in and are flagging everybody. So we either go in the direction of believing that there's a deal been made with God, or that a deal with God is impossible. No deal could ever have been made with God. There's no intermediate, there's no middle ground as far as that goes. Now, as far as taking the direction of saying, okay, no deal was ever made with God, is impossible, we can make a gentle landing into that. But that is not like some compromise between the two directions. The directions are completely mutually exclusive. Okay, it's very important. New voicemail. Clear. So, those are mutually exclusive directions. There is no middle ground compromise whatsoever on this. And the ego, this self-delusion we have, this arrogance we have, says, oh, no, there's a middle ground. Yeah, we already found the middle ground on this deal with God. This deal with God is a middle ground between two mutually exclusive positions. No, it's not. It's just sheer arrogance. We said to God, God, you're not perfect. I see very clearly you're not perfect, God. And then God seemed to say to us, because God's perfection is still present, we thought God's asserting that God's perfect. We say, hey, wait a minute, you're trying to contradict me. I'm saying you're imperfect. You're saying you're perfect. So we got a conflict here. No, God's not saying God's perfect. God is perfect. There's no conflict. God doesn't have any conflict. Perfection doesn't have any conflict. With a hallucination that is not perfect, there's no conflict there. But we see it as a conflict. So we say, God, I'm going to show you what a great peacemaker I am. I'm going to bring peace to this conflict. I'm going to tell you how to do it. And you don't seem to understand how to do it, but I do. And this is what we're, the spirit, this is what we thought in our minds. We said, okay, God, I will stop insisting that you're imperfect if you stop insisting that you're perfect. That way we both give in on our position and we reach this mutual deal. We reach this mutual deal. So we made a deal, God. And now we have this new reality that is better than the previous reality, because now we're all-inclusive of all viewpoints. The viewpoint of perfection and the viewpoint of imperfection. Now there's this new that integrates both. And so this ends up, what happens when we believe this? We start dreaming. We enter this dream. And we think this dream is now reality, the new reality. So we go, either we believe in this dream, they made a deal with God, or we believe, you know what? No deal was made with God. We just arrogated this whole thing. If you go in that direction, we're told there's a soft landing. We gradually wake up from the dream, and we make a soft landing. But that is not a compromise between truth and lies at all. It's not a compromise, and not some deal has been made. It's just merely there may be some intermediate steps back to in our awakening is all. But those steps lead us to full awakening. It's not an attempt to fixate a compromise. And it doesn't matter what role you've been dreaming in the dream, as if whether it's a male role or a female role in the dream. It doesn't matter, because you're awakening from the dream. You're setting the dream down. You say, there's never been a deal. But what the problem with women have is that they, being essential and special in the dream, being replicators of bodies, which we feel protects us from the void. That's part of the deal. We think God gave us this as good faith to protect us from the void, which we see perfect freedom as now this abyss, this terrible abyss. So we think that God gave us bodies and worlds to save us from this abyss. And so we think that we're doing God's will by replicating bodies and believing in bodies. And of course, this is simply a dream. There is no deal with God at all. But women having a special essential role, they feel that they're superior in a sense, you know. And so the idea, they feel, I wake up from the dream, I won't feel superior anymore. I won't feel special. I won't feel essential. They think they'll lose that. And so this is a big, you know, big fear that they have, and men are supposed to fix that problem. men say, well, how do I keep women special once I wake up from the dream? How can I keep the idea of specialness going? Because they're complaining about that. Is it? I don't know. It's impossible, isn't it? There is no specialness in reality. You could say all is special. But the fear is, now, wait a minute, I got to make sure the men don't screw up and go off this deal. So there's this fear of breaking the deal with God, breaking the covenant with God, so to speak. The idea of having a covenant with God means a deal. And there's all this sacrificial religions, and all this is all a dream. It's all this belief that we have a covenant with God, a deal with God. There's no deal. There's only empty arrogance, okay, that we have trying to be greater than God. So it is indeed a tricky situation, because men are very frightened that they feel that they have to do what women tell them to do, or else the deal with God will fall apart and they'll end up being swallowed by the abyss. So the men think, well, I wake up, I'm enlightened, how do I keep women special in this? How can I give them a special role? I need, you know, otherwise, wait a minute, there is no deal. But you know, and so, you know, it's like, this perplexes men. It perplexes them, and they're worried about it, because the women tell them that they have to get that right, you know. And so, like the gatekeepers, you're enlightened. If you're enlightened, the women will say, "Great, okay, now, but how did you keep our specialness there in enlightenment?" You know, and the men have to play along with this here, which causes severe confusion in everyone here, actually. Now, the certain traditions, religious traditions, have gotten rid of that, have managed to push that aside, so the men are not so concerned about that. So they're able to be enlightened and then teach that there's no specialness, etc. But under the present world situation, basically the men are under extreme pressure that they have to keep the special role for women going, even in reality where there's no specialness at all, where God has no preferential thought whatsoever. This is something Jesus has directly said to us. I can put that up as a graphic in another video. I actually have a graphic that I've have made about that. I wonder if the graphics are working. Just to give you a little breather here, because we've been going forward. I'm checking it out to see if the graphics work. Oh, they do. I don't want that one. What do I want? That's a default one. Why did it go to that? I don't know. Okay, there's Jesus floating in pure spaciousness. This symbolizes pure spaciousness. Okay, we're all floating in pure spaciousness. Okay, but we think we've made a deal with God, and that God has now given us these bodies and worlds and nature to live in, and that eventually we'll recognize our superiority to God. This is what secretly we believe. So the truth is always knocking at our door. The truth, the emptiness of our arrogance is always knocking at our door, saying, hey, there's nothing to it. There's nothing to it at all. Okay. So the truth is always knocking. Say, hey, this Jesus, do you have your light on? I mean, have you been keeping your light on of truth, you see? There's a light in the door, and he's saying, hey, I'm here. And you've been keeping the light on, so don't be afraid to open the door. So we haven't had this situation that's so severe for a long time in this world, as men were given a chance to breathe a little bit. You see, most of the history, men have been under the tyranny, actually, of the feminine principle. In Egypt, in ancient history, all the way in ancient history, if you really get down to it, just like in Rome, I mean, even the highest men had to go and ask permission from the Vestal Virgins, ultimately. They had to bow to them, because the Vestal Virgins were keeping the fire of body replication going. That's what it symbolized. That's why they had to remain virginal. And if the only thing that they could do wrong was to not remain virginal, have relations with a man, which was the death sentence for them. There's a death sentence that shows the great fear that we have, that if we don't keep replicating bodies, we'll fall into, we'll be annihilated by an abyss. So the whole Roman religion was goddess, based on goddess worship, actually. Even though they had these, you know, strong Jupiter and Zeus or whatever. Maybe that Zeus was the Greeks. But ultimately, the real power was the Vestal Virgins. And like, for instance, if a man was on his way to execution, and if he happened to see a Vestal Virgin on his way to being executed, he was immediately set free, and all charges were dropped. They had the absolute power of life and death over everyone, in all of Rome, actually. Even the emperor, okay. They had absolute power. Except when they had relations with the man. If they were no longer virginal, then they were buried alive, actually. A chamber was built, dug out underground. They were put in there with a table and a chair and a candle, and then it was sealed. They were buried alive, sealed in a tomb. Because, the ultimate fear is that we have some deal with God, and we have to keep that deal, okay? And the Vestal Virgins were specially trained to supposedly know the will of God in this deal and how to keep the deal, you see. But they had to remain virginal to be able to relate to God about this, you see. Yeah. This is what's been going on throughout history. And behind the scenes, the high priestesses and various levels of that there's always those who relate to, supposedly relate to God and to know what the deal is. Even in Christianity, it's the Virgin Mary who supposedly is the intercessor, where Jesus isn't doing things right. We pray to, the Christians pray to Mary, at least Catholics do. Sorry, Christians, I meant, say, like the Roman Catholics do. Obviously, Protestants don't in that way. And she's an intercessor. In other words, she goes to God directly somehow. I mean, and finds out. It's funny, we say that Jesus is God, and then, well, she's able to intercede with Jesus, basically, and say, no, that's not what we want to do here. So in other words, she's some sort of cosmic gate, religious gatekeeper, that if Jesus screws up and tells us to do something that's not in line with the plan of God, she says, no. Or, you know, we complain to her, and she says, okay, don't worry, I'll fix it. This is very, you know, prevalent in pagan, this just shows you the pagan religions always have this priestess, high priestess, who is supposedly knows, can talk with God directly and find out how to keep our covenant with God, our part of the deal with God. And then this priestess, and then informs her religious functionaries, which can sometimes be men, sometimes as women, is often, when you want to do some heavy head bashing, it's the men, and they say, hey, you know, God wants, you know, you to bash these heads over here. So that's what you have to do. If you don't do that, God says all of humanity will be thrown into abyss, the whole world will be swallowed up and destroyed into an abyss, so you must do this. And the men says, oh my gosh, okay. And they're so so terrified of it that they do, you know, they soldier up, cowboy up. But it's out of terror, of fear of being swallowed up by the abyss, that all humanity and bodies will all be swallowed by an abyss. Well, the abyss that we're so terrified of is absolute freedom. I gotta send that again. Sorry about this. This is unusual. I'm being interrupted by the high priestess, it seems. The high priestess is definitely interfering. So what do? I just say I'm taping. That's it. I'm busy explaining truth to the world. This is the dynamic that has gripped the planet, has gripped us. We're not a body. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. No deal has been made whatsoever. None. I'm not part body, part spirit. I'm not a body with a spirit. I'm not a spirit with a body. I am none of that. There's no compromise at all. No deal has ever been made with God. None. Okay. So now I finally get something. Okay. I sent it before, they didn't get it. I said, okay, yeah, I'm taping it. It's okay. Okay, I get the okay. Well, I do it anyway, you know, whether okay or not. But that's pretty rare in this world, isn't it? So essentially we have the return of the Vestal Virgins as these cosmic corporate gatekeepers, cosmic corporate culture gatekeepers. You know, who basically, you know, whatever they say goes. Whatever they say goes. And actually, they had the power that if they said this person needs to be executed, there was no trial at all. They were executed on this, just like that. The absolute power of life and death over every citizen in Rome, Roman citizen, and over all the slaves as well. Because they supposedly knew what the will of God was in this deal that we're trying to uphold. And if we feel we don't uphold it, we're going to be swallowed up by this abyss. And again, the abyss is what? Is actually the perfect freedom, which is reality. So really, we're afraid our arrogance is going to be swallowed up by perfect freedom. But our arrogance is empty. So what gets swallowed up? Nothing. Nothing gets swallowed up. So, yet, you know, we've brought us so much fear, threats and fears upon our minds. We're so freaked out, totally freaked out. I've been freaked out for so long, and now here we go again with this horrible freak out coming upon this world. I'm already freaked out. Just watching this happen, I can't stand it. You know? Yeah. It's like, once again, we're right back into conquest. And we may think, well, we're making this planet peaceful, but I guarantee you this planet will be used as a stepping stone for further conquest in the cosmos. That's actually the blueprint for it. It'll be also a R&R place for the efforts of conquest. And very nasty. And so if you don't get to the root of the situation, which is the so-called deal, and understand it at this level, then you're very vulnerable. And I don't see how you can succeed, really. I don't know. Because I see even that those who claim that they've recognized their true nature or whatever, they seem to be getting pulled into this whole gatekeeper situation as well, and don't really know how to deal with it at all. Or they just kind of fade away, and their voice just has faded away from this planet. Yeah, I understand that. Where have they gone to? I mean, it's amazing. The disappearance of all these so-called enlightened beings. Maybe they have been enlightened. I hope that some of them have been, actually. The whole tenor of theirs, that either they disappear, or suddenly on their website or whatever, this woman pops up, and now she's co-teacher with this teacher. And what's her qualifications? Well, she spent a year or two with the teacher or something. Or she married the teacher, or they're having a relationship, or she's just, because she's, it's not explained, really. It's just, she's there now, and this is what we're doing now. Okay. And so the man says, like, there's this guy in Australia who claims he's Jesus, okay? Who's there with him? His sidekick, Mary Magdalene, of course. And of course, she's the one who's the gatekeeper. She's listening to everything and says, well, he didn't quite mean this. And she smooths and spins everything, okay? Spins it and smooths it out. And she has her own teaching now, which is, cosmic corporate culture, gatekeeping teaching. All of it is. All that's going on. And that's what happens. And of course everyone just says, no, that's the will of God. This is great. We're learning how to work with God. Really getting back to working with God. This past 2,000 years has been terrible. The men, they didn't work with God properly. That's why the planet's all messed up, we say and stuff. No, it's messed up because there's too many people here. There's too much fear and materialism here. That's why it's messed up. The teachings of religion have been to be austerity. The planet wouldn't be messed up. Celibate austerity. How would the planet be messed up from that? It's utterly ridiculous to lay the problems of humanity at the feet of so-called male-dominated religions. They tell you to live in a monastery, live in a nunnery, no children. Have one bowl and one pair of clothes and some sandals and a staff, and that's it. How is that going to destroy the ecosystem of the planet? They said no science. Science is a very bad distraction, and it'll ruin the planet. Look what's happened. Once we give science the go-ahead, look, they're the ones that have ruined the planet through the Green Revolution, causing this massive doubling of the population in several decades. They're the ones who are pillaging the planet. Now, if we had followed the so-called male-dominated religions, we would be sitting in contemplation in a simple dwelling place, using maybe a little simple fire or something like that, or basically staying warm with some wool clothes. The planet would be very pristine, actually. It would be very pristine. So it's an abominable lie to somehow claim that the male-dominated religions have led to this planetary crisis we have, and now we need to bring in cosmic corporate culture to solve the problem for us. No, it's cosmic corporate culture and their science and technology and belief in viewpoints and measuring God, that God can be measured, and there's this deal that's made with God. They're the ones who have brought about this crisis. And then they're blaming the ones who would have avoided the crisis, because they want a crisis so they can have an excuse to take the planet over. I mean, how can you blame a celibate tradition for a population problem? Now, it's true Roman Catholicism. The thing is, brought in so many pagans into the church, and the pagans insisted on keeping their traditions, that the church said, okay, you can have your, you know, mother of God thing and all these traditions. And they say, hey, we got to keep the population going. That's part of the deal with God. We got to have as much replication as possible. And so the church sort of made this compromise, which is not a good thing. But previously, I mean, it held up celibacy as the highest good and the most very, very important for everyone is stop replicating bodies. Stop replicating bodies. This is not God's plan, actually. Not at all. And so paganism has, you know, so there are farm families I know who are like in Catholics, you know, like in Mexico, for instance, I know there's a lot of farm families. The woman has 20 children. That's not uncommon at all, 15 to 20 children. And they think they're doing the will of God. You know, what can the Catholic Church do? You know, they're trying to at least bring something into them, get them going on the path, but they can't just say, hey, body replication is out. You know, people would freak out and panic and drive them from the land. So you can't lay it all at the feet of the Catholic Church, actually. They try to evangelize the pagan world, you see. But the pagan world, the fundamental belief they have is that there's this deal with God, and they have to keep this deal going, and they have to do it through replication of the bodies, be fruitful and multiply. But the real roots of Christian teaching are something very different than the way it's ultimately going on right now, but even though that some of that is still carried through, actually. But certainly, you can lay the blame at cosmic corporate culture and the so-called scientific advances here, prolonging everybody's lifespan to an extraordinary extent. The insane medical insurance situation now, where there's this unbelievable expenditure on pharmaceuticals and hospitalization and treatments as you get older, and making young people pay for all of that. It's an absolute abomination. It causes young people to feel that they have to basically endure a sweatshop life for their whole life. They have to go to college, get a good paying job, and just to keep the whole system going, and then work their slave away, and then I need time for contemplation. You know, it's a dastardly a system that they've set up. Because all these baby boomers are now are reaching the age, and they want to live to be 100, right? And they just will use any procedure whatsoever. I mean, some of these people have dozens of procedures throughout their later lives, dozens of them. They rack up bills in the millions of dollars, and their pharmaceuticals they take is another, probably some of them, extraordinary amounts of money are spent. And you get an aging population. How can the younger population keep paying for this with their, you know, why? Everyone has to be insured. Everyone has to pay insurance. That's why they're doing it. And the insurance rates are going to go up. So it's a crime now if you don't have insurance. Now, I never have any medical procedures done, never have to take any pharmaceuticals. But I have to pay exorbitant amounts of money for medical insurance. And basically, I just work to pay medical insurance, by and large. And I'm enslaved by it. So it's a hideous system that they've science and technology has brought to this planet under the guise of making life better. No, it's enslaving everyone in many, many ways. Plus, the insane increase in population, along with the materialistic mindset that you know, if you don't take the spiritual path, you're going to be a materialist, period. You'll be frightened that you need to keep a deal with God. And the way that you think God is telling you to keep this deal is to acquire better houses, better things, be materially happy. That's how you feel. Because this seemingly protects you from the abyss. The more you seem to have, the more control you have, the more things, the more you think that you're protected from the abyss. And the more you're terrified to be a renunciate without anything. You think, oh my God, I'm on the edge of the abyss. So a secular, materialistic, humanistic, deal with God world increase its population, will increase its material usage of material resources in this planet, and will essentially destroy the planet. And cosmic corporate culture has destroyed many, many planets. Many, many planets they have destroyed. That's why they're on the rampage to find new ones. They need the resources. They used it all up. They destroyed their atmosphere. They wreak havoc upon planets. And of course, they say they're here to save the planet. And they play the good cop, bad cop thing. Oh yeah, well, there's good aspects and there's bad aspects. Some are really help the planet and some hurt the planet. And they go through all the song and dance, but you never hear them clarify the whole issue about the deal, any deal. Why are we even believe we're bodies or planets even exist? That only can come about through our belief that we made a deal with God. There's no other way. There's no other way, because we would not even view it. If we were recognized there's no deal with God, we would know our perfect freedom, and we would not view anything as fixated whatsoever. We wouldn't see it as a world. We wouldn't see this as a body. We wouldn't see this as identity. We wouldn't see this as a dwelling place or a home. We wouldn't view it that way at all. So the very fact they view it that way means they do believe that a deal has been made with God. This is very cut and dried. There's no wiggle room on this. One of the great aspects of Jesus' teachings are that he leaves no wiggle room whatsoever. Very cut and dried. If you feel even the tiniest taste of the grave, you believe that a deal was made with God. Period. No way around that. And so this is very, very helpful for us to recognize, those who also want to be free of suffering, this helps clarify for us. Either we believe a deal was made with God, or we don't believe a deal is made with God. Either we believe it's possible, or we believe it's impossible. It's either one or the other. Either a deal can be made with God, or a deal cannot be made with God. There is no in-between. You can't say, well, a deal can be made with God, but also no deal can be made with God. You can't say, no deal can be made with God, but also a deal can be made with God. Those are mutually exclusive. Right? Mutually exclusive. And you can't use radical Dzogchen to try and cook it up, cook the books with that, which it seems like you can do it. You know, I mean, it's like an accountant cooking the books. Even though that's not what radical Dzogchen says at all. But the way that's presented is, you know, is like both truth and lies abide in pure spaciousness. You know, it's talking about conceptualization, all abiding in pure spaciousness. But pure spaciousness doesn't have any fixation. Either pure spaciousness can be fixated or it can't. You do not have the proposition that it can be both fixated and unfixated. That is not what Dzogchen says at all. So... The books cannot be cooked. Okay, either a deal can be made with God or a deal cannot be made with God. There's no middle ground. There's no middle ground there whatsoever. And again, I pointed out in previous video that the middle path of Buddha, for instance, is not a middle ground. He said middle path, not middle ground. There is no middle ground. There is a path that avoids certain entanglements, etc. But not a middle ground. As a final compromise. On the way back, as we awaken from the dream, we may find ourselves in some realm that is not quite yet fully awake, but much, much better. Or it's somehow, you know, we're still perceiving. That may be true. But that's only a step that we're taking towards full awakening. That's not a middle ground. That's established as a compromise. Not at all. The direction still remains there. The direction's going towards full realization that arrogance is empty. All arrogance. Well, what arrogance is there? Could there possibly be except the belief that we could be greater than God? That's the only arrogance that's possible. And that's empty. So I know this is unusual teaching, because you're not going to get this listening to Ramana Maharshi or Nandamai Ma or even Longchenpa or any of these teachers, really. And so you're hearing this for the first time and say, what in the world is this? But this really is a fuller exposition of Christian teachings and Jesus' teachings. brought into the real politic of the situation, that you know, the pressure that our minds are under, as we cling to this belief that there's a deal, or we try to assert that there isn't a deal and try to help others realize this here on this planet. Obviously, we're going to get flagged for doing this. There's no question about it. You can't get enlightened and go, you know, say what I say, get on television and say, everybody, you know, this is what's going on, and clarify it. You would be off there, and they would try to, you know, expunge any possibilities that ever even existed, that anything like this could ever even be said. Corporations would completely freak out. The entire, you know, planet would freak out, saying, no, that God's going to get angry at us because somebody here is speaking out against the deal, that is telling us we don't have to uphold our end of the deal. We can negate, default on our part of the deal, and God's going to be so angry that he's going to swallow us all up into an abyss. This is what they actually believe. This is a core belief. If anyone believes they're a body at all, their core belief is that, again, if we don't believe that we're a body, God's going to swallow all bodies and worlds into an abyss and annihilate them all. That's the core belief that they have. They believe that a deal was made with God, plain and simple. And to extend what Jesus said, if we feel even the slightest taste of the grave, that means we still believe that a deal was made with God. It means we're sinners. We're sinners. I mean, to believe a deal is made with God is the sin of spiritual arrogance. So we're all very much sinners. That's one sin, and that's spiritual arrogance or spiritual pride. But I could call it arrogance, because to arrogate to yourself that you have the power to force a deal upon God is, you know, that is arrogance. There's no one else you could try to force a deal upon anyway. God is all. So we are struggling with this arrogance, no question about it. And to talk about it and to bring it to light like we're doing here is what we need to do. We have to stop running from it. We have to stop feeling being pursued by it. You know, we have to say, wait a minute, God's not pursuing me. Nothing's pursuing me. I'm just imagining it. I just don't want to look like a fool running away in panic and from nothing. Yeah, so I imagine that, you know, furious God is after me. Of course, the gatekeepers are telling, oh, yes, God, you know, they may not say God. But what they really say is the abyss. the abyss. Of course, you can always think that when God, the deal that God made with us is that God is no longer God. It's just the abyss. But God gave us this way to cling to something so we're not swallowed by the abyss. This is our, you know, this is the deal that we got out of it. And they say that we must keep replicating bodies. We must keep, because that's our life. And so they're very, very, very frightened if you say anything other than that. Very frightened. Now, it is true. It is a fact that over the last several thousand years, where we've been getting this more true teaching, religions have had an effect of at least spreading, hinting and spreading, and we're getting some feel for it, that the high priestesses and the radical feminists and the feminine part of replicating bodies has felt oppressed, has felt that their viewpoint has not been heard, and has, of course, because their viewpoint is that a deal was made with God. So of course, if you're spending time focusing on that no deal was made with God, those who believe that a deal was made will feel that their viewpoint is being oppressed, they're not being heard, they're going to feel that way. But they feel that way because they're mistaken, not because they're being oppressed, actually. You know, you to give equal relevance to truth and lies is insanity. That's arrogance. So what it really means is they've just simply been clinging to their arrogance all this time and waiting for the cosmic corporate culture saviors to come and finally get here and, you know, throw off the chains of their oppression so they can, reclaim the full-throated arrogance. And that's the feel I get from these operatives of cosmic corporate culture. Many of them, Most of them, as gatekeepers, are female, actually. And I feel they're extraordinarily arrogant. This is the spiritual feeling I get, and it's shocking. I just say, whoa, that's an extremely arrogant mind. And it's frightening. And it's quite frightening. Arrogant minds are quite frightening because they demand your enslavement to fear. They say, we're enslaved to fear. We're doing our part. You got to be enslaved too. Otherwise, we're going to be annihilated by an abyss. And I'm saying, no, that's not true. There is no abyss. I don't have to be enslaved to fear. And they say, no, if you don't be enslaved to fear, we'll all be destroyed. And this is the arrogance that they're projecting, that you have to do what they say. Otherwise, you'll cause the destruction of everyone. Killed Jesus. They said, hey, Jesus, you know, you're not going off the program here, and you're going to cause the destruction of all of us, so we got to sacrifice you. You got to be destroyed. And then they destroyed Jesus, and they thought that God was so happy. God says, oh, okay, I see that you kept your part of the deal. You destroyed that, you know, that terrible Jesus who came here to tell you the truth, that there's no deal. How dare Jesus say such a thing? So they felt they did the right thing, and now God looked upon us favorably from now on. They say, oh, I can really trust you to keep your part of the deal, because you were severely tempted by Jesus to drop the deal, but you said, no, we're going to kill him, and not going to allow that kind of nonsense to come here. And so somehow, you know, humanity says, ah, we're saved. God's now going to keep realizes that we're faithful covenant keepers. Faithful keepers of the covenant, that we rejected the truth here. We rejected that crazy notion that no deal is possible with God. We absolutely rejected it. Crucified Jesus, spilled his blood here on the planet. And we keep eating him every day to remind ourselves of his crucifixion, that we're loyal to making sure we keep our part of the deal. So, and we have to remember to laugh at this, because it is all silly. It is all simply absolute arrogance, which is empty, and our ridiculous efforts to camouflage it, we have to realize it's ridiculous. And we have to realize that God sees through this. God doesn't even look at it, actually. Perfection is not looking at anything. God is not like that. The allness is always present. God doesn't have any preferential thoughts. There's no God. No, the idea of a deal never arises in God. God views us as the way we've always been, perfect. That's all. God has never stopped viewing us as anything less than perfect. That's all that God sees, is the absolute perfection of all. We're the ones who are dreaming this crazy dream. Now, the Holy Spirit is a blessing from God, which is able to work with this dream and help, you know, help us come, you know, sort out this fear. And we need to laugh at the fear. We need to see how silly it is. And that's what I do here. That's what I do. This is part of the awakening, not part of a judgment at all, but part of an awakening. This is helping the awakening, not laying judgment on who's bad or good, because there is no deal. So the idea of, well, who's threatening the deal is a moot point. Nobody's threatening the deal because there is no deal. So I'm not judging the fearful ones in that way, but I am bringing to light their silly demands and saying, no, we're not going to accede to those demands. Those are crazy demands. It just pulls us back into fear of a non-existent boogeyman. There is no deal. They're just, you know, still caught up in their arrogance and the continuity fear of, like, how do I let go of this arrogance? You know, that's the main question. How do I let go of this arrogance? I'm afraid I'll lose the whole world and bodies and everything. So we have to look into this gentle landing, you know, the idea that we have to have a viewpoint is nonsense. There's only view. There's no viewpoint. There's no viewpoint. There's only an oceanicness of allness, and there's not a specific viewpoint. Okay, and that's the idea of a forest and climbing the tree. That bear is trying to climb the top of the tree to get free of the viewpoint. actually. The viewpoint is like the tree coming down. It represents a viewpoint, and we all have this viewpoint, and we're in a forest. We're lost in this forest, a dark forest of viewpoints. But actually, there's only one view, and that's it. There's just one oceanic, all-encompassing view. There's no viewpoints. And we're afraid that's a swallowing of from in the abyss, you know. So we have to get over this fear of being swallowed by an abyss. I came across something quite interesting yesterday that Longchenpa said. He said that think of all appearances like as magic, in that actually it's a belief in the absence of pure spaciousness. It's an absence. Look at it as an absence, a temporary absence. I said, wow, that's quite an interesting take, isn't it? Magical emanation that is simply a belief in an absence of totality that generates this, all these appearances. Anyway, we'll get to that. It's, you know, eventually we'll see all of that. But we really, I don't know what to do about this takeover, this cosmic cult, corporate culture, hostile takeover, and the gatekeepers flagging everything. And people are feeling, there's no question, what's happening now is I'm finding people are turning back to bad habits. You know, I was watching music videos. That's a bad habit. Elvis Presley. Elvis Presley was like the king. You know, he's the king of the jungle, the tiger, king of the jungle. And he had James Burton, you know, chicken picking away on the guitar there. The band was just rocking in Vegas. And you see all the women there just like freaking out. Elvis just like shaking in their heads and just, you know, absolutely, you know, ecstatic. And you think, hey, Elvis could do anything. He didn't have to do what the high priestess said. Oh yes, he did. Yes, he did. And if you saw Elvis a couple years later, you know, he was turned into a fat blob, and then died on the toilet from all the pills to keep him going, like, you know, entertain us. Wow. So the idea that somehow you can be such a popular entertainer that maybe you get some slack from the high priestesses, you know, that doesn't work. It doesn't work, because the high priestesses above them is the extreme fear that there's a deal, and we have to keep our part of the deal. And it's very difficult and tricky to keep our part of the deal. If we mess up at all, we'll be annihilated. This is what they believe. So they don't cut slack for anyone. They can't say, oh, well, it's okay if you mess up. I like you. It's okay if you mess up the part of the deal. And they say, wait a minute. We'll all be annihilated. The earth will be annihilated. Everything will be annihilated. Oh, my God. No. Off with your head. They even said off with Jesus' head. You know? I wouldn't be surprised if the Vestal Virgins actually ordered his execution. And that's just not written about in history. Of course, the executioners are men. They're just the operatives, you know, the thugs that the priestesses use to enforce compliance. They're the muscle to enforce compliance. And of course, they take the blame. They take the blame too. Which is very convenient. It's very convenient, isn't it? Rarely does the blame ever rest upon those who actually give out the orders. There are levels and levels and levels here in this world. It's all a defense system, actually. This dream is all a defense system. Frantically defending against what they feel is an imminent threat from God. And they feel that God is just can't help itself, and needs to be placated, severely placated. We need to get on the good side and say, God, how can we keep you from annihilating us? You seem to be always pressuring us that way. And frantic fear in this dream. The arrogance brings out frantic fear in us. Arrogance that there's a deal with God actually results in a frantic fear of annihilation. And a desperate attempt to ward off that annihilation. And that desperation takes on this form we call world and nature and bodies. This is all a desperate, desperate, frantic attempt to ward off annihilation by an abyss. And again, there is no abyss. The ocean is not an abyss. It's everything. And Ramana Maharshi says that silence is the most powerful of all. And that actually silence is saying everything. It's all, everything that can possibly be said. Silence says everything. It's not an absence of speech. He says it's all speech. He says the sage is not inactive. The sage is all active. So silence, he says, contains everything that can possibly be said. And that when you say something, you actually lose a lot of power and effectiveness. That the most effective transmission of truth is silence. Now, I'd like to sit with Bhagavan Ramana Maharshi in his silence, that is for sure, and just experience that and see what it's like. See how it goes. So the ocean is not an abyss, it's everything, it's all potentiality, it's totality. How is that an abyss? It's an abyss if you want to believe in the absence of totality, but that's a very crazy thought, way of thinking, isn't it? That to say that the absence of an abyss is an abyss is essentially what we're saying, and that's an arrogant statement. It's denying truth, reason, right? It's very arrogant. Say that the absence of an abyss is an abyss. That's really our standpoint in this world. Those who believe that they're a body, they believe that the absence of an abyss is an abyss. And so they believe that to protect themselves from this, they believe that they've forced God into a deal, that God has no choice but to accept this deal. That God has to stop asserting that God's perfect, and we'll stop asserting that God's imperfect, and there's a deal there. We believe that God has to accept this deal. Otherwise, God isn't God. God's not perfect if God doesn't accept this perfect deal. So to accept it, God has to say God's imperfect. And to not accept it proves that also God's imperfect. So damned if you do, damned if you don't. That's arrogance, isn't it? So this teaching here is sharing. He's catching everybody off guard because everybody has all these nice defenses, spiritual defenses. That they use, they can go back to, and yet I'm not saying what anyone's expecting to be said here. You say, wait a minute, how can I cook the books on this? And we have to laugh at it. Don't feel attacked or anything, because look at it and chuckle and say, oh, that's funny. That's right, because that's exactly what I do. It's exactly what we all do. How do we cook the books on this? Wait a minute, I've got to make some graphics and listen to some music and. How do I cook the books? Let me go research this. Let me see what Ramana said. I can twist that, or let me see what Longchenpa said and I can twist that, or what Jesus said and I can twist that, and cook the books here and make sure we don't get on the wrong side of this deal thing here. This deal thingy. But the just incredible shift in attitude on this planet. The incredible rise of arrogance on this planet under the guise of quote-unquote women's liberation, that was just a front for the cost will take over this planet by cosmic corporate culture. And now you have those who are aligned with that are now feeling incredibly arrogant. They're reeking with arrogance. And they think that they're victorious liberators, here to liberate us from some hideous darkness. The hideous darkness of believing that there is no deal. We don't have a deal with God. It's impossible to make a deal with God. They view that as the hideous darkness of the abyss. And there are these cosmic liberators here come to liberate us, and they're drunk on what they believe to be their greatness. And we're like, look at him, like, you got to be kidding me. Are you really this messed up? I guess so. It's pathetic, it's sad, but what can you do? Ultimately, all the teachings, and so many of the teachings we've gotten, have to do with how to placate this God, this so-called God who made a deal with us, to make sure that we do our part with this deal. And the real truth is that there is no deal, never has been. So there's no God to be placated. That doesn't mean there isn't God. There's just simply no call to placate God. There's no reason to placate. God is perfectly equanimous, perfectly equal, perfectly loving, perfectly all-inclusive, perfectly supports all potentiality for all, always. God is pure love, as Jesus said, perfect love, meaning God supports all potentiality for everyone, always, just like parents will support their child, say, yes, you can have this, you can do this, I support you. God supports all potentiality for all, always, so you can say God is perfect love. And that's it. That's all that God is. In perfect freedom, perfect love, perfect freedom, perfect love. Perfect freedom is perfect love, actually. And perfect love is perfect freedom. So that's what God is. That's what God is. That's what Jesus came to tell us. And people said, whoa, wait a minute. You know, what about the old Mosaic law about how to keep Jehovah off our backs? You know, we need to hear about that. And so Jesus, you know, couldn't really just, he tried not to say anything about it. And they stuffed words into his mouth a lot, because they're frantic. They say, wait a minute, you're from God. Well, tell us, you know, why is God so angry at us? What do we got to do to make sure that God doesn't get furious with us? And of course, death is part of, we are imagining that this is part of the covenant we made with God, that we have to give something back to the abyss. We have to feed the abyss with death. So we can only have these fixations are only temporary, and we have to have new fixations, continuously keep bringing up new fixations. That's part of the deal too, that even though we can't hold on to fixations, we can bring new ones into existence. And we feel this is the compromise we made with God. Because God, there's no fixations in reality, right? So we said, well, reality's totally fixated, and then we come to a compromise saying, well, there are fixations, but they're not permanent. But we can continue to bring in new fixations. In other words, new bodies. So we keep identifying, our mind keeps identifying with new bodies. Once this one dies, well, you know, we identify with a new body, a new fixation. Okay, and we think we're keeping the covenant with God. Now maybe you're thinking, I can't believe you. I can't believe I'm hearing this. I thought I'd never hear this stuff. You know, it's like, I thought I'd never get to this stuff. Well, yeah, I feel the same way. But I always knew that we have to get to it. You know, we have to get to this. And it was super difficult because really nobody is speaking like this in the world. I said, what's the matter with everybody here? What, you know? I guess they feel that they're not going to get any good fixations in the future. So they're not saying anything. I don't know. Their silence is pretty strange, very strange. And so we just don't think we're ever going to get to this. And I said, we got to, we have to get to this. Otherwise, we'll be going along with the notion of this deal and be very, very much involved with all of the antics that are involved with this belief, as we have been for so long already. You know, we'll be reinvesting in the same old nothingness. Camouflaging arrogance is all we're doing. Failing to see the emptiness of arrogance is all we're doing. And that the price is death for that. The price we pay is death, which is tasting the grave. It's really all, death is really a living death. A living death is the price we pay for this fear of the abyss, for this, for our errors. And we think, well, God is the one who's, no. This is how we had to structure the believed in compromise of, we're saying there's fixation. God said there's no fixation. We say, okay, there's temporary fixation. That's death, isn't it? That's the compromise we think that God has agreed to, temporary fixation. And so here we are thinking that this is our life. Temporary fixation is our life. Sure, the world's impermanent. I mean, Buddhism points it out impermanence, and it doesn't say why. It doesn't stress it, doesn't emphasize it. We're saying why right here. We're getting to the why of it. Why? Okay, so this is a, I think, a more complete teaching here. And that this was my goal. I recognized that there was a lack of this teaching in this way, the big picture teaching, really. So I said, I'm going to do this. It's necessary. It's very helpful. The impermanence is because we think we've made a deal with God. We believe reality is imperfect. We said reality, all reality is fixated. And then God is saying, no, there's no fixation whatsoever, zero. So we said, okay, let's both drop our claims. I'll drop that it's totally fixated. You drop that it's no fixation, and we'll agree on temporary fixation. And voila, we have this so-called dream of impermanence. It's exactly why we have it. It's that simple. And so we say, oh, I don't like this dream of impermanence. How do I get free of this dream of impermanence? How do I need to meditate, get free of this dream of impermanence? Well, drop our arrogance. Drop the arrogance. Repent, as Jesus has told us. Repent, repent, repent. Kingdom of heaven is at hand. Okay, there's no fixation at all. Repent, repent, repent. Repent of your arrogance. Repent of your arrogance. It means change your mind. Say, hey, okay, I can't be greater than God. It's impossible. And I've been, the price, the wages we pay for arrogance is this living death, which is this impermanent fixation. Experience of impermanent fixation. We call nature, world, bodies, and subtle realms are same way. You know, that's this dream in all its vast, seemingly complexity. That's the price we pay. The wages of sin is death, as Jesus put it, or Christianity puts it, the wages of sin is death. That's what sin pays you. Sin pays you with death. And what is sin is the belief in compromise, a deal with God has been made. That is sin. And where does that come from? Our arrogance of wanting to be greater than God, which is impossible. It's empty arrogance. So, of course, our defenses struggle with this information, right? Supposed to. We're not supposed to try and stop this information. And we find out that we have all these clever defenses, a lot of them spiritual. Yeah, I can rattle off this and this and this spiritually, you know, but it's a defense. And so what's being said here is this complete, more complete exposition of the situation. Maybe because it's time for that, as I said. Maybe it's because it's time for this and we're willing to look at it. Whereas before, maybe the people were not under so much pressure. They said, well, we don't really have to worry about that too much. Well, we definitely have to worry about it now because the pressure is on us to reinvest in our arrogance and to believe a deal was made with God and to reinvest in trying to find better ways to keep that covenant. Okay. With bodies, time, space, process, and form, a way to reinvest in trying to find better ways to keep that covenant and to make it a perfect covenant. This is the pressure we're under. And we certainly do not want to go that direction. Therefore, we need to see the whole situation very clearly, and how, you know, and look at our arrogance and laugh at it and see it for what's really going on here. Again, this entire dream of impermanence, which religions have talked about, you know, suffering, everything's dependent origination, it's all impermanent, blah, blah, on and on and on. Well, yeah, but why is it here? Why are we dreaming? Why are we dreaming? Sure, we want to get free of it, but why are we doing it in the first place? Again, because we believe we made a deal with God. Let's go over this again. We wanted to be greater than God. To be greater than perfection, we need to see that perfection isn't perfect. And to see that perfection isn't perfect, we literally end up having to believe that everything is fixated. And this basically says reality is not real. It's fixated. Freedom isn't free at all. It's actually fixated. There's process. There's causality. There's all this fixation. And then reality, though, seems still to be perfect. We say, okay, there's a disagreement. Let's split the difference. Let's come to a compromise. We'll say that reality isn't always totally fixated. If God, you will agree to this compromise, we'll say, okay, and you will give up saying there's no fixation. We give up saying there's total fixation. God gives up saying there's no fixation. We arrive at this compromise that says there's temporary fixation. And we also need to keep identifying with this temporary fixation. So we keep on identifying with this, what's called, you know, impermanence, which is really the belief in temporary fixation. So we're just dreaming, we're believing this, dreaming this covenant. God never made any such covenant. God always remains as there's no fixation whatsoever. There isn't any deal to be made with that whatsoever. None. We're just dreaming that a deal was made. That's it. The whole dream of impermanence is just a dream that a deal was made with God when in fact there wasn't any. Now, well, we can do a little. Let's not. I don't want to expand it too much. Into details. We're just getting the big picture here. That's what we're doing, and that's all that's needed. Really, is the big picture. That's big picture. As far as addressing certain people will throw questions at you and stuff. We'll wait till we're familiar with the big picture for that. We're not going to try and throw an anchor down right now. You know, they throw anchors at us. We're not even on the ship. We're free. You know, we're not. We can't even be anchored anymore. Get to that. Get to the view. There is no point of view. There's just view. There's one view of no fixation. That's the one view. There's no crystallization, there's no fixation, there's only freedom. And we don't quite understand what that means. That's okay. Deep down we know what it means, so we're just kind of groggily awakening from our dream of temporary fixation. Impermanent, dream of impermanence, temporary fixation. That, yeah, this body will be fixated for, you know, 80 some odd years or whatever, and then it will dissolve its fixation, and then actually what will happen is then we'll identify with another body that has another lifespan of 80, 90 years, and identify with that, and that just goes on and on and on and on. As long as we believe in, you know, they made a deal with God. As long as we believe we made a deal with God, we are going to be bound by this dream of impermanence or temporary fixation. There's no way around it whatsoever. Even though we're in the so-called higher subtle realms, that too is impermanent fixation. That doesn't last. That part of the dream, that doesn't last forever either. You can't escape it that way. You can't climb the corporate spiritual ladder like that and escape this dream. The dream of temporary fixation, dream of impermanence, is completely made up based on our belief that we force God into a deal. See, we believe we force this deal upon God, that God has no choice but to accept it. And the fact that we're here talking about this proves that God accepted it. This is what our belief is. It proves it. Because we said if God doesn't accept this deal, then God isn't God and has no say whatsoever. So we wouldn't even be here like this. So we think that this fact we're here proves that God accepted the deal and that there is a deal. Again, sheer arrogance. The notion that we can force a deal upon God is absolute sheer arrogance. No deal was ever forced upon God. The fact that we're here doesn't prove that any deal was accepted. It proves that God is still God and that we're dreaming that a deal was forced upon God. That's all. We have to be here. There's nowhere else to be. So it proves is that God is the same as always, really. But the impermanence of all this, all that means is that we're dreaming, arrogantly dreaming that we forced a deal upon God. That's it. So again, the two directions, the sheep and the goats, what's that two directions? One believes that a deal with God was made. The other believes that no deal with God is possible. So we talk about the two different directions, the parting of the ways. It's very obvious what your orientation is. Either a deal was made with God or no deal was made with God. Either a deal with God is possible or a deal with God is impossible. To put it in more abstract terms, but less abstract terms, is either a deal, we have a deal with God, or there isn't any deal at all with God in place. None. So this type of taping absolutely affects me. It leaves me tired, leaves me shaken, because saying this is of course counter to the cosmic corporate culture gatekeepers who are working frantically and rapidly, fiendishly working to make sure everyone here on this planet believes that a deal was made with God. And of course, they believe the extraterrestrials have a better, clear idea of what the deal is. Because that's what the ETs told us, told this planet. Hey, you know, they say, we have a really much higher understanding of what the deal with God entails. I mean, look at all these gadgets we have, you know. And we go like, wow, really? Yeah, you must really know what God wants, right? And then they told those who would listen psychically, they said, what God wants is God wants you to work with us and help us educate this planet about what God wants. The deal, this planet's way backward. It doesn't understand. We've had this terrible male-dominated religions here who have been regressing you and holding you back from what you need, the progress you need to make. And that's like, God's very angry about that, and it's causing an imbalance in the whole cosmos. And the whole deal is jeopardized by what you've done here. So we need you to help throw off the shackles and chains of oppression, historic oppression, and be liberated from the dark ages and this dreadful, you know, deceit here. And that will bring the whole cosmos will come into balance as God's wonderful design and plan finally takes full shape. And we're just about ready to get this perfect equilibrium that'll last forever. And then we'll all be happy forever after. This is what they come telling us. It's the glass beads that they come bringing us, actually. And it's utter nonsense. Worse than that is sheer arrogance. They're arrogating qualities and attributes to God that God doesn't have whatsoever. First and foremost is that we can't change God in the slightest bit. And God is absolute pure freedom to all. And there is no designer plan. God does not have some cosmic blueprint. God is not the designer of universes. God does not have to have us has a script and a guidebook to tell us how to follow the script. God does not have roles assigned to us. All of that is just a dream of arrogance. And we will not be swallowed by the abyss if we recognize there's no deal. We will have a gentle, soft landing into awakening is what will happen. And we do not have to figure out a compromise between this and what the ones who insist in compromise believe in. See, those who believe that there's a compromise made with God insist that they can compromise is the way to go for everything. So no matter what you say, they feel they can keep their own position until you figure out a compromise between truth and lies. See, their basic position is that compromise between truth and lies is possible. In fact, they've done it, and this is all proof that it's doable. It's not proof. How is a dream proof of reality? How is a wishful thinking proof of reality? There's not any proof at all. So, is it what's going to happen here? I don't know yet. I don't know yet. Hopefully, I will get a clearer picture of that. Hopefully, I'll get a clear picture. Okay, I think it's time. We're going to wrap this one up. We're not going to go the full scope. So, I appreciate everyone's attention. Do not fear, do not fear, do not fear. We are going to get more and better, clearer picture of, you know, how is the whole thing disposed? How is it going to work out? Okay? We will, I hope, I pray we get more information. And meanwhile, we will continue to get, you know, greater and greater clarity. Get familiar with all this so we're not bothered by it. And we can laugh at the whole thing. Laugh at our silly arrogance, the idle wish of the empty arrogance that we've tried to believe. We forced a deal upon God. We can breathe and say, oh yeah, I know that. And I don't believe that anymore. Okay. Very great. That's it.